There, you don't even need to see the menu. You know what I'm talking about. You've been there. It's like, you go to Patty's, okay? Now, I try to vary through the menu, and they've got a lot of different stuff. But what they're known for is what? This pork chop that's like enormous. Okay? Some of you don't like it. That's okay. You can be wrong. But can you imagine, like, all week long, and Patty's is one of those special places in this area. If you're not from this area, that's the place you got to go. You know, especially at Christmas time, there's like 16 million lights all over the place. It's just maybe not quite that many, but there's a lot. And they have this pork chop. It has a sauce on it. It's the nectar of the gods. It just pours straight from heaven. It's glorious. And you've been waiting on it. You know, it's usually like one of those once-a-year restaurants you get to go to. It's a real treat. And it's like that week, and you're just starting like, oh, yeah, this is going to, oh, pork chop. I'm coming for you. I'm coming for you. And then when you go, I don't even need to see a menu. Do you need a menu? No, not me. I don't need a menu. Not, I'll have the 2-inch pork chop. And the lady looks at you, and she says, sir, I'm so sorry. We're out of pork chops. And all of a sudden, your heart starts to melt like your best friend just moved away or something. What do you do? I mean, that's what you're known for. How in the world can you not have that one thing that you're known for? Or worse yet, and this I'm still offended about. I don't get offended, but this offended me. Okay, and I'm just going to bear this out here this morning. Back about a year and a half ago, I go into Cracker Barrel. Is everybody still following me here? And Scott knows where this is going because he was there. And this is the thing. This is what I always get, used to get. Said, you know, I'll have the beef stew because I like to put cornbread in it and make this beautiful concoction. And she said, sir, I'm sorry, we don't have that. And I said, oh, well, I'll just come back tomorrow and get it. She said, no, we've taken that off the menu. Just trying to put thoughts together in my mind, wondering how in the world could you have lost your mind to remove that one thing that I come here for that I just love. Not only do you not have it, you decided that we're not ever going to sell this again. I don't boycott places, but man, if I ever came close, that was it. That's where I draw the line. And I was so upset because they removed something that was what I was so craving in that place. Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 16, and we're going to connect that with something this morning in the church. Guys, I've been stirred up these past couple of months. You've noticed. And I want you to think about that. Either we're out of this or we've removed it. Okay? Everybody follow me. We're going to break this passage up. Mark chapter 16, verse 14. Because there's some things that people come to church for. You know, you might not come to church for a 2-inch pork chop. I wish we offered that. But there are some things that people come in the door for because they need to experience. You understand what I'm saying? And it's a wide variety of things. There's some people here this morning. You walked in because you need a family. You need people to come gather around you, those relationships, because you're just empty and broken. And the truth is, maybe we're in that place where, I'm sorry, we're fresh out of that. My friend card is all filled. I don't have time for that. Or maybe you, like Miss Sandra, walked in and you need a miracle of God in your life. Let me tell you, it's time for the church to start giving what the Lord has placed on the inside of us. And if we don't, then I'm telling you, just like I stopped going to Cracker Barrel to get the beef stew, they're going to stop coming and running to the Lord when that's the place that they need to be going. All right, does everybody follow me this morning? Mark chapter 16. Interesting start here. Verse 14, it says, after he appeared to the 11 themselves, they were reclining at table. You know, I love this about Jesus and the disciples. They're always just kind of taking it easy. Aren't you thankful for that? I mean, over and over, they came and they were reclining at table. Thank you, God, that it's not all just work, 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 work for the Lord. He wants us to rest in him too. Aren't you thankful for that? But they were resting in something that they didn't need to be resting in. They're chilling out at the table. They got the lazy boy, bam, remote control in the hand, soda. They didn't have any of that, but they were reclining at the table. And Jesus comes up and he says, hey, I'm going to rebuke you now. Don't you love it when Jesus rebukes us when we're taking it easy? Like, no, Jesus, this isn't rebuke time. This is recline time. Grab your pillow. Recline with us. And it says that Jesus rebuked them for their unbelief and their hardness of heart because they had not believed those who saw him after he was risen. Now, I know Easter was a month ago. We're already a few weeks past Easter, but is it okay a few weeks after Easter if we talk about a risen Lord for a moment? Is that okay? Because what happened, and I preached a sermon a few weeks ago, everybody doubted this. And it's not just Thomas, it's the disciples. Everybody's doubting what is the core of our faith. And Jesus comes up at this time, you know, they've all been reconciled. He's appeared to them, and he comes up and he says, hey, you know what you did back there? That's not okay. I told you that I was coming. I told you that I was going to rise again from the grave. And even when you saw me, there was doubt and unbelief in your hearts. Your hearts were hardened because things didn't go the way that you wanted them to. And I just want you to know, I'm not okay with that. And he rebukes them. Now, that is just a wonderful start to this story. Because I want you to see, oftentimes the Lord chastens those whom he loves. He disciplines those that he loves. He rebukes those that he loves. And I feel like we've kind of got in that place as followers of Christ that rebukes are not okay for us anymore. Let me tell you, you never get to that place where the Lord doesn't constantly rebuke you, where he doesn't lovingly chasten you. And there's a reason for that, because he's got something for you to do. And he wants us to remain pliable in his hands, this moldable vessel of clay that he can just use for his glory. But if we're living around in this constant state of hardness of heart, then we are taking the clay out of the Lord's hands that he wants to use for his namesake. And he just rebukes them. That's not okay. That doubt, that unbelief, that hardness, that's not okay. And there's a reason he said that. Because then comes this awesome mission. He says, go into all the world. Now, the great news is, aren't you thankful, after your parents used to spank you, that it wasn't like, okay, I'm going to give you a spank, and now we're not going to be friends anymore. Our relationship's over because I had to chasten you. I have a little 12-year-old boy back there. We have had to apply the rod of correction, the Board of Education, if you know what I'm talking about. Mr. Spoon. Mr. Spoon. Why did I do that? Because I hated my son? No. Just like the Lord. The Lord disciplines those that he loves. But when that was over, let me tell you, that was always followed by, come here, boy. And I held him. I loved on him. Let him know how much I loved him. And just reassured of relationship. The Lord's rebuke was the same way. It wasn't, hey, you guys are just the worst, your unbelief, I'm done with you, I'm going to go get another dirty dozen, another 12, you're out, you missed it. No, see, that might be the place you're in this morning, but the truth is, God's not finished with you yet. I don't care where you are. I don't care what you've done. God's got a calling on your life, and it's time that we understand, well, the Lord's been hard on me. It's because he's trying to get some junk out of your life. You know, that sermon hurt, Richie. Well, take the hurt and learn from it. You know, God's been showing me things about myself I didn't want to hear. You know, the truth is, the gospel's not easy, guys. The word of the Lord is oftentimes not easy to receive. But we need to be in this place where we can hear, we can receive, we can take it. And he says, okay, now that's not okay, but now I've told you this, let's do better. Now I've got something for you to do. go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Now, I don't know how many people are here this morning, but let me confirm something to you. That's not just for the disciples. You're not just sitting here breathing air and taking up space. You are commissioned by the risen Son of God. You're commissioned by the risen Son of God. The one who breathed life into your body has commissioned you and said, I got something for you to do. Go. Just go. Go and carry me everywhere that you go. Let me tell you a word that should have never come about. Closet Christianity. You know, I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm going to be a Christian so I can go to heaven. But I don't really want to talk to people because that's not my spiritual gifting. That's a cop-out. And you're selling yourself short. And more than that, you're selling our Savior and our King short. See, we're ambassadors of the Lord everywhere that we go, and it doesn't matter where you are. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes it's easy. Sometimes you're rejected. Jesus said, guess what? Not everybody's going to like this. And that's the truth. But everywhere you find yourself is an opportunity to show Jesus' love to someone, because the world desperately needs it. I picked up Derek Owen from the airport, I guess a little over a week ago, and we're walking down in the Gulch in Nashville. Just had coffee at the Barista Parlor, which is my favorite coffee in all of Nashville. We're walking back around the corner, and there's this man comes up, and you can tell he's just kind of straggling around. And I said, hey, how's it going? It's a nice day, isn't it? And he just looked up at me because, you know, you could tell nobody had talked to him that day. And I said, hey, what you doing? He said, I'm looking for a job. I said, well, I'm Richie. It's nice to meet you. He said, my name's Jesse Jackson. And I said, keep hope alive. No, I didn't say that. I said, well, it's nice to meet you, Jesse. Let me tell you. He said, every time I go, every time I knock on, they just slam the door in my face. And the Lord just quickened something to me. And I said, you know what? I serve a God that opens the door that no man can shut. And I said, let me tell you something. He's got a calling on your life. And God's about to open up a door for you that not anybody can shut in your face. And when that happens, I want you to know that that's happened because Jesus loves you and he wants his best in your life. And he just started beaming. And I said, can I just pray that that happens? He said, absolutely. So I prayed over him, and you could just feel the presence of God down in the Gulch. People walking by in their hipster outfits looking at us like we're weirdos. I could care less, because the truth is we are called to give Jesus to people. And a lot of times we see that as, well, yeah, missionaries go across the world. That's not happened. We've not completed the Great Commission because people have failed to take that personally. Man, I was so inspired on the Equip cluster on Wednesday night as Derek Owen was talking about the gospel. Man, it just really grabbed me. He was talking about the Moravians and how some of them sold themselves into slavery on their own free volition that they could reach unreached people groups that could not be reached any other way. They voluntarily went into slavery to reach those people for Jesus. Wow. Well, that can't be the Lord. No, that's the epitome of who Jesus is, where we love not our lives unto the death. Whew, man, isn't that awesome? See, I've lost you when I talked about selling yourself into slavery. You were starting to think for a moment, I'm called by Jesus. No, that's not me. I'm not telling you to sell yourself into slavery. I'm telling you to sell yourself out, and every person that you meet, realize they're not in your life by accident. All right, that's not the meat of what we're talking about today, but it's really good. All right, Jesus rebukes them. He says, I'm not done with you. I'm sending you out. And then this passage right here, this is going to be our focus today. These signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. Ushers, while I'm finishing this, get the boxes out of the back. And it's a joke. Lock the front doors. They'll pick up serpents with their hands, and if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They'll lay their hands on the sick, and they will recover. Sandra, let me tell you something. What you experience from the Lord, there isn't a person in this building or in your life that can take that away from you. That's a gift from God. Why did that happen to her? Because we serve a God that is amazing. Because she believes. And because she believes, Jesus said, as you believe, there's going to be some things that follow you because you believe. Now, I'm going to deconstruct some terrible theology. I want you to listen to some of these educated, I'm just going to call them educated. This is Family Sunday, so. They're not good people. They're not wise. People are like bending themselves into pretzels like contortionists, trying to act like that this isn't in the Bible. Why would you even try to take that out of the Bible? You know, if you're in a place of desperation, why are you trying to say that this doesn't exist? All right, I read this out of Barnes's notes on the Bible. The Christian, now, we just read what Jesus said in Mark chapter 16, these signs will follow those that believe. Barnes's notes in the Bible says, the Christian should be satisfied that the promise was fulfilled if these miracles were ever actually wrought, though they do not occur now. And the believer now should not expect a miracle in his case. Miracles were necessary for the establishment of religion in the world. They are not necessary for its continuance now. What? Bingel's Nomen says, though no doubt these early miracles of the New Testament have made for the Lord Jesus an everlasting name, that power does not exert itself on our day. Out of the pulpit commentary, it says, these signs shall follow them that believe. Such evidences were necessary in the first dawn of Christianity to attract attention to the doctrine. But our Lord's words do not mean that they were to be in perpetuity, to continue going as a continually recurring evidence of the truth of Christianity. These signs were necessary in the beginning of Christianity in order that the faith may take root and increase. It must be nourished by miracles. For even so, when we plant shrubs, we only water them until we see that they're taking root. And when they have rooted themselves, we cease to water them. Guys, this is foolishness. This is just ridiculous. I mean, I'm sorry if you disagree with what I'm saying. I've refused to live a life without the supernatural miracle work and power of the Lord on display. I don't want to go to Patty's and then be out of a pork chop. I don't want to go to Cracker Barrel and say, I'm sorry, beef stew's no longer on the menu. Let me tell you, we are the church of the living God. And the supernatural miracle working power of the Lord is not something that ever needs to be taken off of the menu. I'm telling you guys, we are ambassadors of Christ. And he says, as you follow me, I'm going to send some things to follow you. Man, aren't you thankful for that? That he still is close as the mention of his name. And some of it, I mean, they're educated. They're really, really educated. But it's so ignorant in their philosophy. Why would the Lord remove that from those that he loves? Why would the Lord remove the ability to display his magnificent power in a world today?
Well, that was needed in the beginning so we could establish religion. And once it's established, just like a bush, it doesn't need to be watered with miracles anymore because it's firmly taken hold.
So live the rest of your life in belief that I did miracles once upon a time. Guys, I'm sorry. That's so ignorant. That's so ignorant. And I'll tell you why. Because I don't think anybody would disagree that we are called to go into the world and preach the gospel. But could you imagine the book of Acts without the miracle working power of the Lord on display? It would be non-existent. And if we refuse to have that on the menu, not that we're serving something up here, but in essence we are, we're just displaying the King. Guys, that is the entryway. That is the entryway to see the Lord just erupt. It's unmistakable. Here's what he's given us. He said, this will follow you. Number one, they will cast out demons. Stop being afraid of demons. Stop toying with them and entertaining yourself with them because they're not entertainment. And a lot of times we open doors of access in our lives for demonic activity because we're fooling around with stuff we don't need to be fooling around with. But the truth is, it's nothing to be afraid of. Jesus says, as you go carrying my name, I've got something for you. It's called authority. See, the truth is, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. And a lot of times we just say, well, I'm not really in deliverance ministry. That's not my spiritual gifting. And some people actually get shocked when a demon manifests itself in somebody. Where do you think they went? And a lot of these educated people that wrote these things, they don't question if the demonic's still real. They just question if the Lord's still moving in us to get rid of them. He's given you authority over every unclean spirit. Aren't you thankful for that? All right, I'm going to keep going. He said, if you believe in me, I've invested my authority in you. Greater am I in you than anything else out there in the world. Second thing I'm going to give you is, you're going to speak in new tongues. Praise the name of the Lord. I am a tongue-talking Christian. Some of the visitors here, uh-oh. It was hidden until now. We're in one of those churches. Hurry, I'll meet you in the front. Act like you're going to the bathroom. I'll meet you at the car. Stop running from speaking in tongues. That's one of the most powerful things in my personal life. Stop acting like it's some party trick that we had display for people. Hey, watch this. It's the most powerful, practical thing I've ever experienced in my life, ever. See, the Bible says in Jude, build yourself up in your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Those that deny this is here, do you not want to be built up in your faith? Is that what we're trying to do? I don't need to be built up. It's powerful. It's practical. And it's time that the church recapture the practicality of the Holy Spirit. And stop running to the mystical. Church, I'm going to dispel something. The Holy Spirit is not a goosebump. Okay? The Holy Spirit is not a goosebump. Now, he can do whatever he wants to do. He'll move every emotion that you have at times. But the emotion is not the Holy Spirit. It's a reaction to the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we become so infatuated with a reaction. And sometimes the Holy Spirit's not in our reaction. But let me tell you what the Holy Spirit is. He's powerful. And he's practical. It's not mystical.
It's not a level of spirituality. It's a powerful, practical application. And I believe it's time that the church recapture this, guys. Because truth, older generation, I want to tell you, this is not a rebuke, just informative. We have scared the younger generation because they don't understand. We've not presented the practicality of the Holy Spirit in the way that Jesus has. Is that right? That is right. I've had a lot of young people come to, I don't understand this. What? Then, I mean, it starts right here. The buck stops here. We've got to understand. When Jesus says, I'm sending you out to go, I'm not sending you out with an empty tool belt. I'm going to let you have an ability to connect with me on a level that you can only imagine. All right. Snakes, poison. Don't do that. Just stop. Visitors, this is not one of those kind of churches. I would be the first one to meet you at your car. We'd go down the street and see if Patty's has pork chops. What is that talking about? Don't tempt the Lord your God. I'll tell you what it is. It's a divine protection over your life. As you go, Jesus says, don't be afraid of anything that could come your way. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to cover you. And I've experienced that time and time and time and time and time and time again in my life. Praise the Lord for his divine protection. Well, if I go there, if I go and obey the Lord and go, I really feel like he's called me to go here. What's going to happen to me? The truth is, in the center of God's will for your life, that's the safest place you could ever possibly be. Always. We sing about it. Three kids and a fire. He walks through the fire. You know what? That's the safest place they could have been that night. Right in the middle of a furnace. That's kind of crazy. No, because the Lord was protecting them. And he was with them. Anytime you obey the Lord and you go and you carry his name, you can expect divine protection. This man right here taught me this. Every meal that we've ever prayed over, he claims verses of protection over. That's powerful to me because the Lord's promised that. You'll have protection. Is everybody still following me this morning? Are you having fun? Church is supposed to be fun. And then he says this. Okay, you have protection. And you're going to lay your hands on the sick. And they'll recover. I'm going to give you the power over every unclean thing. Guys, it's time that the church operate in this again. Man, don't you desire to see more of what Sandra experienced and others have experienced on a daily basis? See, some of you might have been thinking, wow, it's worship time. No, it's time to glorify Jesus is what it's time for. Man, I want to see the powerful manifestations of miracles and healings on display. I want to see those that we hear words like, there's just no hope. Doctors haven't given me any hope. That's God's best time to move. Haven't you seen that, man? God does his best work when everybody else says it's over. And then, because he doesn't like sharing his glory with other people, he just kind of erupts in this way. And then it's inexplicable, unexplainable. I don't know. Those words mean the same thing. I prefer inexplicable for some reason. That's a rabbit trail. But anyway, think about it. It's unexplainable. And then God shows up. And it's like, wow, how did that happen? I can't explain this. You're not supposed to. You're not supposed to be able to explain the Lord. And whatever you do, don't sit there and say, well, I must really be something. Hallelujah. I'm the best. Praise the Lord. I'm going to make me a business card, miracle worker. Hallelujah. Yeah, pretty fancy. No, just get on your knees and realize you just stepped into going like Jesus told you to do. He said, go. And let me tell you, those miracles, it's not formulaic. And a lot of times we've reduced the Lord to a formula.
I pray for you in this way. This is what happens. God's so creative. He can do whatever he wants to do. You notice this morning I'm wearing my running shoes. Back about 9 years ago, I had surgery on both of my Achilles. It's been a long decade. I can run. I can do whatever. It's all good. Still have some weird side effects of stuff. Like it formed my leg. I don't really have a muscle on the inside of my leg. They had to detach that. I don't want to get gross, but they had to detach that on both legs, and it caused the outside of my legs to kind of form in a different way. The muscles built up there instead of on the inside. Praise the Lord. It's all good. I'm recovered. But one lingering side effect that I have is on Sundays, and I think it's this concrete floor, and I'm extremely active. You know, I'm walking and whatever, not just standing. Sunday night, you have no idea. My wife, I have to act like I am a three-year-old, but I sit there and I said, you got to rub my legs. They will ache. They will seize up, man, from my knees to my ankles. And I don't know if it's the concrete or if it's like dress shoes mixed with concrete. I don't know what it is, but they just ache and ache and ache on Sundays a lot. And I told her, I said, forget it. I'm finding the most comfortable pair of shoes in my closet. If I'm wearing a suit, I'm just going to wear tennis shoes with it. That's the way it's going to go. But anyway, one of these Sundays, this was awesome. So awesome. We had spent the weekend down at Antioch. Our African-American brothers and sisters down in Memphis had an amazing trip. It was so powerful. I had to leave on Saturday. I mean, I love you guys, but I really wanted to stay, but I had to come back. Next morning, Dale Barkley shows up with something. He said, by the way, God really moved last night, and I'm going to be honest here, Dale. And he gave me something. It was a bottle of water. He said, don't drink this. I said, okay. I noticed the cap was loose, so I wouldn't have drank it anyway. But he said, last night at church, man, there was a miracle anointing in this place. They anointed the baptistry water. And he said, miracles were just happening left and right as they anointed people with water out of the baptistry. And I thought to myself, I've never shared these thoughts, that's really odd. And he said, I brought you a bottle of it home. And I thought to myself, what am I going to do with this in my flesh? Well, that night, not that I was judging any, I guess I was, but, well, that's not how I would really prefer the miracles to happen. How long did that water sit in there? I don't have any idea. Started thinking about the germ theory of disease, and I mean, just mine went down into the utter depths of dementia there, and it's just going like, I don't know if I even want to touch the outside of the bottle. What if some of the baptistry water got on the outside, and now that's germs that somebody's been, I don't know what's happened to this water. But I put it in my car that night, preached two sermons, and walked, man, one of the worst leg cramps I had ever had. Both of them just knotted up. You felt like golf balls. And I'm sitting there, man, went home from church. I'm tossing and turning. I'm like, God, heal this. Heal this, Lord. I cannot take this anymore. Tried to sleep. 11 o'clock comes. Just tossing and turning. Man, I took aspirin. Or whatever it was, some pain reliever, nothing. I'm rolling around. 12 o'clock comes. 1 o'clock comes. Not slept a wink. Just legs just cramped up and seizing. 2 o'clock comes. 2:30 comes. And I remember the bottle of water. And I thought to myself, self, at this point, I don't really care about the germ theory of disease. I just want to see your power on display. And furthermore, I am miserable. My legs hurt so bad. I mean, it felt like the entire leg was just all the way down to the bone, just like a massive leg migraine. I don't even know if that's a thing. It is now. And it hurt. And Jenny was asleep, and I did not wake her up.
because I didn't want her to know what was about to happen. But I did not care at that point. I just wanted to see God move. 2:30 in the morning, I got up. I sit in the bathtub, and I felt weird as can be. I took that bottle of water, and I dumped it on my legs. Instantaneously. I don't mean like I was able to go to sleep. They felt better the next morning. Instantaneously, God healed my legs that night. Now, does this mean, okay, healing service, God, let's anoint it again. He might not ever do it that way again. He probably won't. But the truth is, he's creative. He's creative. And all we have to do is obey. Because the truth is, as we go, he says, man, I'm going to give you authority. I'm going to give you power. Just expect for me to do it. See, I'm kind of hard-headed. I had that bottle of water right there. I had no idea what I was going to do with it. I had it there for 6 hours. But finally, I decided, you know what, God? This is not coincidence. I'm hurting. Dale gave me this in faith. You know what? I'm going to apply it to my body in faith. And the truth is, he moved just like that. Why does stuff like that happen? Because I'm a believer. And he says these signs will follow them that believe. Why do they follow us? Well, the first thing I can think of is it's an act of God's grace and love towards us. Why does God want to heal you? Because he loves you. Man, he loves you so much. And it's not salvation by grace, healing by works. Everything that comes from the throne room is an act of grace towards us. And man, he loves us. He loves us. He loves us. He loves us. That verse that says, if your Father on earth knows how to give you good gifts, how much more does your Father in heaven? Come here, Trey. Oh, you're in trouble now, boy. This is one embarrassed boy. Just walk with me for a minute because you're going to like what's happening. Put your head up. Oh, my goodness. Teachers that have him in class, this is not who Trey Clendenin is. I can tell you that right now. He is not a shy bone in his body. But I can tell you something. I'd give this boy anything. Anything, 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 anything. Let me tell you something. Put your head up. Anything also includes a spanking. No, I'm just kidding. I take delight in giving this boy stuff. Well, you're spoiling your kid. Yeah, I probably am. You know why? Because I love him. And man, I just want to give him everything that is within my power to give him. There's been something that this boy has wanted for about 6 months. He's been asking for it. Stop looking for it. He's expected, praise the Lord. He's been looking for it. He's been trying to concoct in his view of money how he can afford to pay for it. What is this that you want?
Nintendo Switch.
He wants a Nintendo Switch. And, whoa, okay, that's okay. That's my boy. He wants a Nintendo Switch. Some of you are thinking, what's a Nintendo Switch? Some of you that are parents are tired of hearing about the Nintendo Switch. Everywhere you look, they're sold out. And you look at the price tag, I'm sure it costs like 30 cents to make, and they sell it for like 1 million times the price, because that's what they do. But let me tell you, regardless of the price tag, regardless of how many times he's asked me, "Dad, I'll give you my allowance. I don't care. I want a Switch." Do you know what I've been doing in my off time? He has no idea. I've been looking in every store that I go in for a Nintendo Switch. It's not my thing. Just video, well, kids are wasting their time on video games. Yeah, they probably do a lot. That's not the point of this. The point is, he wants it, and I'm his daddy. And if it's in my power to give it to him, I will give everything I have to see that smile come across his face. Why? Because that's what fathers do. Same thing with healing, guys. Same thing with seeing the Lord move in your life. He's not withholding from you. Some of you have feel like you've been held out on. You're actually kind of ticked at him. But the truth is, he loves you. He takes delight in going in every storehouse of heaven. Oh, this is what Richie needs right here. I know he wants it. I know he wants it. And he takes delight in pouring his blessings out over his children. See, why do signs and wonders follow those who believe? Because those that experience those signs and wonders, Jesus loves with everything on the inside of them. Him. Trey, I'm telling you, boy, a Switch is coming. I don't know if you deserve it. No, you do. And it's coming because I love you. Same thing with signs and wonders. They follow us because they're an act of God's grace and love towards us. Second thing they are you still with me this morning? Second thing that they are is the evidence that the Holy Spirit has gone to the Father. I preached a sermon a few weeks ago, and my last point of it, talking about the work of the Holy Spirit, that he takes what, everything that the Father has is now mine, Jesus says. And the Holy Spirit, I will send you the Helper. He will take what is mine and declare it to you. Everything that you read about, everything that you know that heaven is like, that's why Jesus said, pray like this, as it is in heaven. Wow, on earth as it is in heaven. See, that's just nice spiritual words we pray. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He is the mailman of heaven, taking from the very throne room of God and bringing it and declaring it over your life. And isn't that awesome that God loves us that much? That he would send the Holy Spirit to display the power and love of God in our life. That's why they follow us, because he loves us. Because the Holy Spirit has come to bring those things to us. They also come because it is a gift of the Holy Spirit. This is kind of different. You know, not everybody flows in the gift, but it's one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit that we read about. Working of miracles, working of faith. And I'll tell you what else it is. They come because it's a platform for evangelism. Why aren't we seeing signs and wonders? Well, I guess that question needs to be asked with another question. Why aren't you going? Why aren't we seeing signs and wonders? I think a large part of it is because we're not going. We're expecting to sit and receive, and Jesus says, go and receive. Go into all the world and these signs will follow you. It's hard to follow something that's sitting still. Hey, I could really get on a soapbox here. Guys, this is what the culture of church has become. Come in a building and sit and expect and receive. Let me tell you, God wants to bless you.
He wants to pour his blessings out on you. But church is not a bless me club. Church is not a place where we come and just get. I want you to look around at these people beside you. Do you not realize that this is your family? And this is a place that God has placed us to come and empty all of ourselves to serve one another, to give to one another. And when we leave the doors, we go collectively to Marshall County, to this region, to make the name of Jesus great. And as we go, we're not going alone. He says, I'll send some things that will empower you. I'll send some things that will give you a platform if you'll only be faithful to talk about me. Why aren't the signs and wonders here? Because we're being disobedient followers and disciples of Jesus Christ. See, that's kind of an oxymoron. Disobedient and disciple just don't go together. We're being disobedient converts is what we're being. Because disciples are obedient to what Jesus tells us to do. You want to see the miracle work and power of God on display? Go. 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 I don't want to go. I want to come. Church is a place where I come and receive. No, not really. It's not what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be a family. It's supposed to be where we come and just love each other and we worship our King together and we kind of sharpen each other's iron. I'll be honest. The days of Bless Me Club religion, they're quickly coming to an end, guys. They're coming to an end. It's time for us to be obedient. You want to see this county change for Jesus? Step out of your box and go. See, if you remember, the story started with them just taking it easy, reclining, and Jesus shows up. I don't know. I kind of feel like that's a picture of where we are. We're kind of kicked back. Somebody's waving us with a palm branch, feeding us grapes of the worship songs that we like, waving us with the prayers that we want, just taking it easy. Go. Go, go. All right. These signs will follow them that believe. That goes for everybody here. Everybody here. Every person in this room, man, God wants to unleash the power of the Holy Spirit in your life and through your life. Isn't that awesome, Dale? You're a carrier, man. You're a carrier of signs and wonders. And if you look behind a Christian, it's supposed to be this litany of just signs and wonders everywhere because that's what Christians are. It's what we do, but like Patty's, it's like we've sold out of pork chops. Or we've just removed them from the menu like these educated people have done. We're not going to serve that. The truth is, that's the core of who we are. They want to follow you. Richie, I don't know about me. Yes, you. Well, I'm not very boisterous. It doesn't say these signs will follow the boisterous. Well, I can't sing too good. It doesn't say these signs will follow anointed worship leaders. I'm not a teacher. These signs don't follow the teachers. I'm not a pastor. You're the pastor. These signs will follow you. You're the paid Christian after all. These signs don't follow the pastor. Guys, look how awesome it is. These signs follow those who believe. Who believe? Now, you probably didn't even realize that that's part of who you are, and that's your experience, because you know that you believe. Welcome to the Signs and Wonders Club. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All right, I keep going back up here to get to my next point, but I just got to get through this. So then the Lord Jesus, after he had spoken to them, was taken up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached wherever, while the Lord, look at these next three words, worked with them and confirmed the message by accompanying signs. Worked with them. How often is that the picture of Christianity in 2017 America? We enter into the work of the Lord and he works with us. Or have we created some structure that we expect Jesus to come and bless? God, here's how we do church. After all, we are Christian Fellowship, the apple of God's eye in Marshall County. Bless us. Let me tell you something. Just like the cloud in the book of Exodus, I don't want to go somewhere where he's not. And I don't want him to come fill my mess or my empty structure. I just want him to work with me. I want to work with him. I'm working for him. But as you work for him, he comes along and works with you. Man, I'm telling you, the kingdom is expanded a lot more when we're doing kingdom work and Jesus is working with us. How do we get this? We have to stay on message. We have to be a people of obedience. And number three, we have to be bold about power. Say, stay on message. We've got the greatest message the world's ever seen. Message of grace, love, redemption, forgiveness through Jesus Christ. Don't change the message. The message is perfect. There's no message that needs to be changed. Not one thing about the message needs to change. It's perfect. It's redemptive. It's grace. It's mercy. It's the blood. And it's true. But the message gets lost because of lack of obedience. You have to stay on message, but you have to be obedient. Well, I don't like what he's telling me to do. I rarely do. Well, that sounds unspiritual. No, it's honest. I don't like a lot of the things Jesus tells me to do. My flesh doesn't like it at all. And then outside of that, you have to be bold about signs and wonders. Bold about the power. And I'm almost finished. But if you look in the book of Acts, they took that story right there, okay? Signs and wonders will follow you. And the disciples come out. The Holy Spirit comes. Acts chapter 2. Tongues of fire. Praise the Lord. Then they go out from there. The church starts growing. And they're coming through the gate. And there's this lame man, and he's like alms for the poor, trying to get some money. Give me some money. Can't you see I'm lame? He was a beggar. And Peter, I can guarantee you these thoughts came through his mind. Jesus, you said signs and wonders will follow me who believe. I believe. I'm going to take you at your word. Because notice the prayer that he prays. He doesn't say, God, Jesus, I think I'm going to step out in obedience here, Lord. I think that you want to do something, Lord. Please, God, just. He was extremely outlandishly bold. And as the man was asking for money, Peter basically says, stop talking right now. I don't have any money. Look at me. I'm broke. But I've got something that's far greater than money can ever buy. And he just pronounces healing over this man. He says, silver and gold have I none, for those of you that want to read it line upon line. But whatever I have, I give it unto thee. Rise and walk. Now, that's not the kind of prayers we pray today, okay? Even when we really want God to heal somebody, we always give God an out. Oh Lord, if it be your will. Jesus, just please, we're asking you to touch Sister so-and-so. God, we believe, Jesus, that by your stripes we're healed, Lord. We don't think you're going to do this, but we love her and we ask that you would. I just believe we need to return to the days of being outlandish, being bold. No, I don't want to see you this way. You know, just get up. Rise and walk in the name of Jesus. Not, Father, if it be your will. How can he do that? Because Jesus had just told him a couple days ago, these signs will follow those who believe. And Peter established it in his heart that I believe. And he started seeing the fruition of Jesus' words in his life. That's all I'm asking us to do as Christian Fellowship Church. Wouldn't that be amazing if we collectively got that and we went into this county with that power, allowing the signs and wonders to follow us, and as they do, not saying, yeah, I'm something, staying on point with the message and saying, let me tell you about Jesus. See, you might have been to church and encountered a bunch of bitter, snarky people. But let me tell you something. That's not who Jesus is. There might be some super spiritual hypocrites, but that's not who my Jesus is. Let me tell you who Jesus is. He loves you. He loves you enough that he wants to pour out his blessings on you and heal you. He wants to totally set you free. For no other reason than he loves you because he's your father that is looking for creative ways to pour his blessings out on your life. Richie, I can't do that. Then you're disobedient because it's what God's called his disciples to do. I'm tired of being disobedient. What about you? That preacher just called me disobedient. I'm sorry. All right. You're quiet. I'll stop talking, but the truth still stands. Father, we ask you today, Lord. Lord, I just want to confess. Lord, I've been a bless me Christian pretty much my whole life. Lord, expecting your blessings and my own disobedience. There's been decades, Father, that I've sat instead of going. And I don't think I'm alone. Father, if we clean this church out, Lord, and people leave by the droves, Lord, the truth of God's word remains. You've called us to obey you, and you've given us the power and authority as we do. Wow. Jesus, to you belongs all honor and glory and power forever and ever. You're the King, Lord, and we are your servants, Lord, not church attenders. Lord, we're the family of God, and it's time, Lord, that we step into the fullness of what you have for us, Lord. I don't think it's a matter of hearts. We want to see it, Lord. We've just been afraid, or we've been nervous, or the truth is, you want to manifest yourself. And it's a promise we can hold on to, Lord, as we step into obedience, that power will follow, that signs will follow, that wonders will follow, Lord, that authority will follow. We can't expect those same things while living a lifestyle of disobedience. So we confess it to you today, Lord, and we ask for you to come. Fill us, Father. Lord, we get back to step one of being a disciple. Lord, we deny ourselves. We take up our cross and we follow you with the weight of the message of the hope of all the world on our backs, Lord. Father, we're yours. Lord, I pray that that Moravian generation will rise up again, Lord, where whatever the cost, even if it means selling myself intentionally into slavery, Lord, to let that message be known. May that devotion for you, Lord, arise again. Because it's just not there, Lord. May that heart cry, Father, just break us, Lord, where all we desire is to see your glory be made known, Lord, in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask those that's going to help us serve communion to come up this morning. Here's the good news. Everything I've been saying is good news. But the very act of communion, guys, is an act of obedience. And it's an act of celebration. Jesus says that his body was broken, that he poured his blood out for us. All of those things were done intentionally and strategically. You realize that by his stripes we're healed. And as we take the bread, that represents the broken body of Jesus Christ. Man, he's a miracle working God. We're going to worship, and as we do, we practice open communion. We ask that you would just come row by row and receive the elements, and then we'll all receive after we've all gotten. All right, first row.
Sweet the sound that saves.